Welcome everybody for coming out. Thank you for coming out to the, I would call it the candidate forum for this evening for the upcoming municipal election. My name is Chris Donfine. I'm going to be your moderator tonight. I will try to keep everybody in time. I'll try to explain the details this evening. And hopefully we can get you guys out of here, hopefully within an hour and three. Depends on what Sean Hatfield's going to do tonight. I'm kidding. I wasn't really talking about Eddie. We're going to do a round of introductions first. So each candidate will have an opportunity to introduce themselves, talk about their platforms, what they want to do for their districts. We'll then go into a number of issue discussions. Those have been predetermined by the Chamber of Commerce. Of course, the sponsor this evening is the Chamber of Commerce. They have five items that they've brought forward. I've taken those numbers and put them in the box, and I'll just draw them at random. We're going to draw, basically go in alphabetical order by first name, and then, so let's say Cecil O'Donnell starts tonight. Cecil, it will then move to the other Cecil, and it'll move to the Eddie, then it'll move down the line. So everybody will get a chance to be first, and everybody will get a chance to be last. So with that, again, thank you for being here tonight. We will take a couple of questions later on from the crowd. So for those of you who want to ask a couple of questions, you have a little bit of time to formulate them. Those rounds, of course, will be 45-second responses from the candidates. And everybody gets a chance to answer on those issues as well. So here's trying to keep everything on time. Again, thank you for being here tonight. And thank you for the candidates for coming out and participating in this. Civics, or being a part of our community, is important to all of us and important to our communities. And I want to thank each and every one of you for putting your names on the ballot. It's something that's always difficult to do. And I wish everyone the best of luck on the 15th. Two quick things. Of course, advanced polls are on the 8th and the 11th. If you don't have your packages yet, I'm going to look over to the CAO that's sitting back here somewhere. Call into the municipal office and make sure that you do have a package to be able to vote on the 15th, of course, Saturday the 15th. Or, of course, on the advanced polls on the 8th and 11th. So with that, we'll do a round of introductions first. And everybody has their list before them, but we'll start alphabetically with Cecil O'Donnell, and we'll pass along the microphones to make sure that everybody can hear us. So, 2 minutes, Mr. O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Fellow candidates, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Most of you know me, but for those who don't, my name is Cecil O'Donnell. I live in Clyde River, which is a part of the Municipality of Barrington. Let me start by saying that I don't have a long list or a pocket full of promises to give to you tonight, but I want voters in District 4, which comprises the areas of Clairpoint, Stony Island, Surfside, and The Hawk, to know that I will listen to you, that I will speak for you, that I will learn from you, and that I will work for you, and assure you, your voice will be heard. A poll was taken a while back stating that 93% of the people polled do not trust the politicians, and that leaves only 7% of us that do trust us. So that is something that we need to work at and change. Municipal governments are known to be the government that is closest to the people, and I believe we can set an example to the other levels of government, the provincial and the federal levels of government. I have served as counselor for Stony Island and Clairpoint, also for the area of Clyde River, and yes, I have served as counselor for Surfside and The Hawk. And serving as your ward for a term, I represented the whole municipality of Barrington. I believe the municipality of Barrington has at least two or three times held a plebiscite which the majority of people voted that they wanted to elect the warden or mayor, whatever the case may be. And today, even today, we still appoint our warden. I'm not running for council because I have all the answers and solutions to all problems, but working together as a team, I believe we can accomplish great things. The good book tells us, united we stand, divided we fall. And that's a good advice even for today.
Mr. Randall, your 2 minutes is well up.
Can I just...
I'll give you 5 seconds. 2 minutes goes like quick.
Thank you very much.
There you go. Thank you, Mr. Randall. I'll go to Mr. Swin, District 2.
Two Cecils in the municipality of Barrington. Good thing we're running a different district. I'd like to welcome everyone here. Especially like to thank the Chamber of Commerce for organizing the event. When I considered running for council, I first had to, I think, come to grips or answer the question, why did I want to run for council? So I thought it was a great deal, and I worked in the retail industry for all my life. I understand the importance of listening to people, asking questions, understanding the problems. I worked in business all my life. I know and understand about the ability to, you have to have, to set priorities and find innovative solutions to problems.
1 minute.
The complex problems while applying common sense. I feel I bring a different set of skills and fresh ideas to the municipality with my lifetime of experience, particularly with all of the various community groups that I've worked with, which would be the Barrington Passage Fire Department, Barrington Area Tourist Association, the Municipality of Barrington Planning and Advisory Committee, the Charlotte County Housing Coalition Co-Chair, the Municipal Rep on the Western Regional Housing. That's some of the things I've worked on and involved in, along with quite a number of other organizations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cecil. Now we'll go to District 4 again, and Katie Nickerson. Now.
10 seconds.
10 seconds knocked off of that. Well, you're ready.
Ready?
It's on.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Eddie Nicholson, as you know. I presently reside in Southside and represent that District 4. Southside, Lowcatcher, Hawkland Point, Stony Island. And I reside there with my wife, Tina, and two daughters, Grace and Hannah. I think by living in the district, it allows me better ability to communicate with the residents and address issues and resolve their issues. Over the past 4 years, it has been a great pleasure to work with a productive council. We have been successful to have 12 plus kilometers of road paved in District 4 alone, an issue that I campaigned on last year, or last election. Also, a $10,000 grant was given to the Friends of the Cape Table Island Light. Struck breakwater in the docking area at the Hawk and on the Cape. Floating dock and construction of an island new park has been completed at the causeway.
1 minute.
As warden of the municipality, I've worked hard to have a united and hardworking council that has allowed us to move the entire municipality forward. It is my goal to continue to provide leadership and work with staff and bring projects and issues to the table that will benefit the municipality and District 4. It's my ambition to see more roads paved throughout the municipality. Some projects that I am committed to work on in District 4 are parking at both ends of Kenny Road, Shoney Island, Also, upgrades to Kenny Road from Southside End to allow for better access, change facilities on those beaches in District 4. A medical clinic dialysis unit is a priority. I will promote minor hockey and figure skating to use the rink or by lowering ice time fees. Economic development is always an issue. And hotel accommodations. Access to high-speed internet has been an issue that has been raised by this council. I am committed to work to improve that on the campaign trail. I've got a lot of input from that. I'd like to thank the residents of District 4 for the opportunity to serve them over the past 4 years. In closing, I respectfully ask for your support in the up-and-coming election for your local voice. Thank you.
Mr. Cook. Yeah. 2 minutes.
Good evening, everyone. A special welcome to Mr. Young Jamon, the Chamber of Commerce and fellow candidates. My name is Jody Croker, Councillor for District 5. I'd like to take the opportunity to tell you what type of person that I am. Overwhelming great choice of District 5, obviously. The type of person I am stems from being raised with a great family genetics for a compassionate mother who does everything for everyone, and a father who has instilled a strict code of ethics. Both are exceptional people and have branded these characteristics in myself. I am the type of person who, before becoming a councillor, assisted with residents of Fort Clyde to gain access to the rail bridge before crossing while their vehicle bridge was being replaced. My contact with the provincial government helped gain access. I am the type of person who, before being a councillor again, was asked by the residents of Fort Latour in the surrounding area to find out why one of the previous councillors was moved away from the community, missed several council meetings, and still held a seat. I wrote both the clerk of the day and voiced my opinion for local paper. I am the type of person who, before running for council, took the time to go to meetings, review the minutes, investigate current topics just before jumping into politics, which seemed to be the smart thing to do. I'm also the type of person, as a councillor, which was approached by the community seeing the back of the layouts form, which I did, and I continue to form an association to help restore the layouts. Many have said this was above and beyond my typical councillor duties. I am the type of person, as a councillor, who does not make any expense claims for travel, conferences, community meetings, meals, or accommodations. I feel it's a specific duty to not place an extra burden on taxpayers. I am the type of person, as a councillor and a businessman, I've contributed to the local economy by being one of the largest employers in the county and having the opportunity to communicate with all levels of government, provincial, federal, and businesses, and government issues. That's just the type of person I am. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kirk. We'll go to Mr. Gorham, District 3. There's not much to say. When you're ready.
Hello, everyone. I'd like to start off by thanking the Chamber of Commerce and the people for their turning tonight. I always think it's important for people get out, meet the former councillors and the councillors. I think we should have more of it. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Joel Gorham, and I am a lifelong resident of Cape Sable Island. Over the years, I had the opportunity to own and operate 3 businesses and have been involved in the commercial fishing business for over 35 years. My present job as maintenance supervisor at Roseway Manor has brought me closer to the senior population to give me a broader understanding of what challenges seniors and caregivers experience. I actively volunteer, and I am a past member of the fundraising committee for what is now San Diego's Memorial Arena. Currently, I'm the president of the Shelby County ATV Association, helping to develop multi-purpose trails for all means of transportation and recreation.
1 minute.
I believe that with my strong fishing industry, involved with different businesses in the local area, I have gained the experience to make rational financial and operational decisions, and I have skills to be a good listener and to navigate through the proper channels. If elected as municipal councillor, I would be a strong advocate for healthcare, creating jobs, infrastructure, recreation, and promoting the Barrington area. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Atkinson, District 2, whenever you're home, you're reset, and whenever you're ready.
Good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome Christian Dumont, candidates, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Murray Atkinson. I'm not reading from nothing, so just bear with me. I lived in the Barrington area now for the past 28 years. I was a fisherman, first part of my life. I was a contractor for a good many years. Then I owned a fish company for a good many years. And I've been semi-retired for the past 8 years. And I also belong to the Pony Use Trail and the Barrington Airlines Club. The Barrington Airlines Club, I've been with that organization for 45 years. In that 45 years, I've been with Health and Welfare for 43 years.
1 minute.
Delivering equipment throughout the municipality. So being with the Lions Club, I'm very familiar with the whole of the municipality. And a few things I like to run on is establish a kidney dialysis in the Barrington area, developed a physical hotel service, new medical center, deliver high speed internet, and we definitely got to do something about the littering in this municipality. We're becoming a tourist industry, and I'm ashamed to say that I live in Barrington Passage, walking down through the litter that I see every morning, walking
10 seconds.
I thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So now we go to Mr. Hatfield and Mr. Green. Whenever you're ready. Mostly from my father, I learned that life is not about what you get for yourself, but what you give away and to help others in community. If kids don't have Christmas presents, you give gifts. And if a family's down on their luck without food, you feed them. And if somebody needs new crutches, then gift them with the best pair that you can find. I learned early that the destiny of our entire community is really linked to the destiny of the weakest, the poorest, and the most vulnerable among us. And that everything we have, whether it's power, knowledge, or wealth, is useless until it's used for the betterment of our entire community. In fact, I believe that's why every candidate is here tonight, to provide what is best for all. I have certainly enjoyed working with others to this end, and during my 7 years on council, municipal policies have changed so that greater numbers of low-income property owners get bigger tax rebates so that they can keep their oil barrels full in the winter. A dentist and doctors have been recruited to ensure local health care delivery. New and sustainable jobs have been created through the expansion of Bayside Home. Our investment in wind energy promotes environmental sustainability and brings long-term economic return to the public purse. Funding has also gone into trail development, picnic areas, and a new floating dock, which increases our prospects as a destination for both recreation and tourism. In terms of future vision for our municipality, I think we need to broaden our base of local health care services to include dialysis and mental health services. We must partner with neighboring municipalities to improve the delivery of high-speed internet, without which we are at an educational and economic disadvantage. We need to continue to promote good projects like turning the CSI school into affordable housing, which meets basic human needs while increasing our tax base. And we need to create a context for community development which is not solely dependent upon the fishing industry. Attracting hotel services or developing infrastructure like cycling lanes brings recreational tourism and business dollars directly into our community. In conclusion, my commitment is to listen, to help people, and to promote in every way that I possibly can the development of this wonderful community that we all love and call home. Thank you very much to all of you. Thank you very much, Mr. Hatfield. And the one woman on the table, thank you for your candidacy here. Tricia Newell, District 5.
Good evening, thank you all for coming out. I'm new to politics completely, so I am still learning as I go. I've been listening to everyone, what they've had to say, what they would like to see in the communities, what they'd like to have brought in. I do agree with all these gentlemen about healthcare and hotels, infrastructure, all that. And if elected, I would do my best to listen, try and bring stuff in, try and help as much as I can. I can't say that anything can be done, but I would do my best to try. And I guess that's about it. I've lived in the community for over 35 years, and I've heard people say what they'd like to see. That's all I have to say about that.
There you go, 45 seconds.
Well, I guess I'm done.
So, so for the extra we had, I guess we
made
up for the extras. Okay, so the next round, there were five questions or five issues that were brought forward by the Chamber of Commerce. I've numbered them one through five. So just so there's no bias on what happens here.
That's okay. No,
she worries about me too much. All right. So this is number three. So number three is, where do you see priorities and opportunities in the district you are hoping to represent and in the municipality as a whole? And we're going to bump over here to starting off with Mr.
Can you read that?
I will, with Mr. Cecil Swim, so I'll do it again. Where do you see priorities and opportunities in the district you are hoping to represent and in the municipality as a whole? Did you get that again? Yeah, the district that you're going to represent and the municipality as a whole. So whenever you are, I'm just going to reset here, in about 45 seconds to answer. For the 45 seconds, I'll do this. At the 1 minute, I'm going to start yelling. Okay?
Okay.
Ready? Go.
What priorities? I have to think that there's a community or the municipality that I think the dialysis plant has to be number one priority to work on. There are many under a number of underserved areas for high-speed internet. I'm thinking of particularly a deal with Bear Point, and it's desperate down there. I think supporting the business community in the which is a big part of District 2 is important, meaning because they provide a large number of jobs, and as well as they supply services locally. Thank you.
All right. So, David Dickerson will be next to us. I should have set you guys together. This would have made more sense. There you go. Eddie, go.
The priorities in my district is obviously roads is an issue through the municipality, but roads were an issue in the district too. The beaches, we have the most beautiful beaches on the eastern side of the island, and I think the development there is speaks for itself. I think access to them, putting facilities there that can be used by locals and tourists alone, I like. As for the municipality, I think around the causeway area speaks for itself too. Those issues were completed by the present council. Worked very hard to get those, and again, it relates to tourism, bringing business to the area. And a hotel, I think, is a priority simply to accommodate the skaters and users of the arena and a local or visiting business people. Thank you.
Thank you. That was 60 seconds. Just so you all have a feeling how quickly that goes by. So Jody, same question.
Thank you. So for our district, roads and snow removal are a priority in District 5. Also lower taxes. We have a lot of low income people in our community. Access to beaches and even having some areas for rest stops have been a priority as well, so we can promote some more tourism and get people in their area. For the municipality as a whole, I agree, is healthcare is a major concern. The dialysis unit, which we tried to achieve here not too long ago on council, accommodations is a big one. Anytime you try to bring business into our community, they have nowhere to stay, so they're going to Shelburne or Yarmouth. And obviously housing is another concern, as we have a lot of elderly people who cannot afford their homes, and they'd like to look at lower income units, and I think we've done a good job ourselves in the last 4 years. Thank you.
Perfect. So we go next to Joel. Whenever you're ready.
I think one of the most resounding problems that I've heard has knocking over 400 homes so far at the doors. It's the doctors. I read in a local paper today that 10% of the population in Nova Scotia doesn't have a doctor. And that relates to 100,000 people. And for myself, I've always had a doctor in the area for over 20 years, and last year that doctor left. and I had a new doctor. And when I went to the new doctor, she didn't know my name. She didn't know what I did for a living. And that was so different, of course. And even my old doctor, when I would go to see him and I would have a stitch in my face, he'd say, "You're playing hockey again, right? Should be wearing that visor." And I think we all deserve a doctor that knows us, knows what we do, give us the best health care. Some of our advantages in the area, I think it's our beautiful area that we have with beaches. Being in the tourism industry for 10 years, we really think we're grand what we have, but we do have a beautiful area that we can develop. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Atkinson. Murray. When you're ready.
Ready. I think establishing a kidney dialysis clinic in Barrington is one of my main priorities. And the other, I've been through the district with high-speed internet. There's a lot of areas in there, in a lot of places in the municipality that don't have high-speed internet. And the children that go to school, parents have to take them to different areas to get this information. But the main concern that I've had through the municipality is littering. I don't know how many places I said, so we have definitely got to do something about littering in this municipality. I think we have something on the books, but anyway, I don't think no one has ever been charged for littering in the municipality. Thank you.
Perfect. Mr. Hatfield.
Thank you. Priorities and opportunities in District 3. I think I've heard many people in Milton as have knocked on doors, and Centerville say that what do we have for a picnic park or a birding area or some sort of a wayside rest stop on the side of the road? Other districts have that. That's a priority. Municipal land has been retained its last term on council for the development of that. So seeing that to fruition, along with housing at the former CSI Elementary School, I think it would be important to put cycle lanes. This might be a big dream, but I think a island shaped like a figure eight, I think it would be beautiful if we could have a shoulder that has cycle lanes. I think ecotourism, it would bring people in to ride the island and to visit our pristine beaches and to access our natural resources. Overall, within the municipality, I think maybe a medical center. We need things like a dialysis clinic that's been mentioned. In addition to mental health services, I think they need to be expanded, and we need more health professionals in here. High-speed internet's a big one, too. Puts us at an educational and an economic disadvantage not to have that in our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Tricia.
I think what we need is, I agree with these gentlemen, internet, tourism, get people here and someplace for them to stay, something to bring them in, keep them here. We also need, Village Dale has, they've done very good so far, but down Port Latour area around, they've overgrown, the size of the roads and that is completely out of control. It all needs to be taken care of, brought down, littering as well, especially, once again, Village Dale. I've seen KFC garbage and Wendy's garbage. If you can take it all the way from Yarmouth to Village Dale, take it home. Like, that's just my opinion on the subject. Healthcare is another one. We definitely need more doctors and just anything to help improve employment, anything.
Lastly, Mr. McDonald, can you get a microphone over here? This is how we're going to get you guys to work together, right?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Some of the priorities I see in District 4 would be, of course, the completion of the road and south side. I noticed in the daily paper that the previous government has come up with $160 million to put the road between, I think it was Cape Breton and Manny Finish. And I believe it would be asked to be a premier and transport minister, or even this whole caucus to come to Barrington. We could work with some of the people that come up with funding that struck our highway. And the other thing I believe is very important, that we need to have 24/7 emergency hospital care, because, you know, some days the hospital is open, some days the hospital is not. See you really made them like that. And if that hospital is closed, we need to go to Yarmouth or we go to Liverpool. Thank you. very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. So that's round one on that. So now we'll draw the next thing. Not very scientific here. There we go. So this is number five. This is the issue of doctor shortages. So it would be an interesting discussion around. Some feel there is a shortage of doctors in our community. What do you think the solution is to retain doctors in our area? This time we start with Eddie Nickerson. Some people, or some feel there is a shortage of doctors in our community. What do you think the solution is to retain doctors in our community?
I think a lot feel that there's a doctor shortage in the Municipality of Barrington. And for the past years on council, I think the councils that I've sat on has been very successful in bringing doctors to the area. But the issue is retaining. I think to retain doctors, we need to build our community, we need economic development, we need to build our arenas, we need to sustain our curling clubs. We need that type of environment simply because a professional doctor doesn't want to come to a community that can't provide his family, his children with those kind of with activities and entertainment. So first off, we need to build our community economically just build our community economically provide an environment that all professionals that want to reside in the municipality and work here. Thank you.
I'm just trying to make you guys keep you to time here. That's all. Not waiting to say you're doing good or bad. All right, Mr. Cook, anytime.
All right, doctor shortages is a major problem in our community. We do have a program to recruit doctors. Dr. Baker are doing a very good job of bringing in students into the area. But one thing is we definitely need a more professional medical center. Students are now coming out of school with the expectations that will be set up in a very professional looking center. I think we have to develop one here in the area to make sure that we retain those people. We also got to look at subsidizing these doctors as well from the municipal, provincial, and federal level. And I think we also started some of that. And getting into the schools, definitely recruiting them, getting them here at an early age, hopefully, you know, keeping them for a period of time. So thank you.
Mr. Gore. Oh, sorry, Mr. X. Mr. Gore.
I spoke on Dr. earlier, and I think it's a two-pronged approach with our doctors. We need to get them here, and we need to keep them here a while. But we've all seen the doctors that are here for a year and pass through. But as I mentioned earlier, they don't get to know your name, they don't get to know your occupation, and all the rest. The council has the ability to form ad hoc committees to gather interesting people from the our communities, put them in groups, get their ideas, share their ideas, bring them to council. That'd be one way that we can come up with new ideas to recruit the doctors. Also to find out from other communities how they do it. Council, by having this open discussion with the people of the American Municipality meeting at least once a year with important issues and concerns. And allowing residents of municipalities to engage in issues that need to concern them on the closely monitored internet site.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Murray Adams.
Basically, number one, I think the main thing is the municipality is getting a medical center here in the municipality would be start to get doctors here and retain the doctor. We have a young lady now studying to be a doctor, get them to stay here, which is the main problem. They want to stay here for 2 or 3 years, and then they're gone. So I don't know really how you retain office in the area here. At the present time, I don't know. Thank you.
Great. Mr. Hatfield. Thank you. Regarding the doctor shortage, I think one of the biggest solutions, we got local people who want to practice medicine in our area, and they're prohibited from doing it because of the College of Surgeons and Physicians. I think council should really be taking on the province and the College of Surgeons and Physicians, because if somebody studies abroad internationally, comes back, they only allow a few people to settle back into our community. So we may have a potential situation now where a local person is fully trained to be a medical doctor, wants to settle back here, and they have to go through all kinds of red tape, and the province is not right. And in some sense, it's like a controlled market. I think these people are functioning in a way that's no longer acceptable today in terms of regulating doctors in rural communities, and I think it should be challenged. I also think we need funding incentives that have been mentioned. State-of-the-art medical center would be a good thing for the municipality, where we could diversify with medical professionals, where there could be not just general practitioners, but people who address all aspects of human health and need. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Newell.
Once again, if you've already heard, we need a better medical center. We need incentives to bring them and keep them here. We need growth in the community to give them something while they're here. And also we need more than one or two doctors, so the doctors don't get overworked and don't feel the need that they have to leave because there's just too much stress on them, too much going on. If you had a few doctors to take the workload off, it would make things a lot better and maybe make them stay a little longer. Thank you.
Good, thank you. Mr. O'Donnell.
Maybe I'm wrong, but I always thought that healthcare, leading doctors to an area like this, was a provincial matter. Somehow the province has made this entity a municipality. And we have sat back and put on the next funding to entice doctors to come to this area. You know, it's wrong, it's wrong, it's wrong. And somehow we got to reverse that decision. I think also that we need to somehow, as maybe a doctor to the area, somehow we must entice our doctor to take part in the hospital at Shelton. The Shelton Hospital is the hospital for the town, not just the Shelton or Shelton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Mr. Swin.
Are an absolute shortage of doctors, like knocking on doors. I've heard it time and time again. We don't have a time for doctors. I believe the secret or answer to long-term doctor shortage is that we need to spend more time recruiting and finding people who will take up the profession, because people from a rural area, if you look at professionals that we have in our community, a lot of them were born and brought up here, and they come back and they stay. And finding someone who's from some foreign country to come here, they're just not here. They're not going to stay. Most of them are here for a very short time. And I think recruiting and finding people to end up locally is important.
Good, thank you. So we get through that one. Now, I'll look around back here. Does someone have a question they'd like to ask? I do have a few more lined up here, but if somebody would like to ask a question, now is the time to ask our candidates a question. And if you have the question, everybody gets a chance to answer it as well. So anybody, just put your hand up and I will share the microphone with you.
You can ask it. Dr. Blair's office was supposed to be a medical center.
All right. So, there you go. So Dr. Blair's So it was supposed to be a medical center, so what's their thought on that? So, since we started with Eddie last time, we'll start with Jody on this one. What's your thoughts on Dr. Blair already having a medical clinic in that one that actually municipality and others helped pay for that?
Well, that particular building was becoming too cumbersome to keep up. It's an older building. And again, we're talking about professionals coming, and when you take a new doctor through that building, they were not excited about working in a facility that was becoming old and no longer purpose. So the municipality took the right move. They got rid of the building, and hopefully we can use additional funding in the future to build something new and innovative that will keep the doctors here.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Joe Wolf. You have a comment on this, and then you can refuse the comment if you don't want to comment on it, but I'm sure as politicians, if that microphone comes to you, you'll actually use it. So, Joe.
Well, actually, I drove by that building many times and thought about the same thing. What is the building being used for? I guess I have a question also. Are we going to contain another clinic? I think it's important for the area. I know that, the province discourages walking clinics, but, you know, with the shortage of doctors, people without doctors, having to go to the emergency department in Yarmouth and wait 10 to 15 to 20 hours to see the doctor, I don't think that's something that we should, as people, that we should put up with. I think we should do, if we can't recruit doctors, if we can't get enough doctors in the area, then we should go for walking clinics. And there are walking clinics in Nova Scotia. Thank you.
Yeah, I would echo the sentiments of
should be very, but it's okay. You'll get your turn. Hurry.
Yes, I'd like to answer that question. I was in council previous 4 or 5 years, 8 years ago, and we were going to build a medical center at that location. I went to the late Mr. Knowles to try to purchase land, and the municipality did purchase, I think, 11 acres of land in behind the old medical center. And that was my intent when I was in previous council to have a medical center put there. But I hear now that that medical center has been sold, but I don't know whether the land was sold with it or just the property that the building sits on. Anyway, that's what I'm going to thank you.
Thanks. Mr. Sean, you're here now.
Yeah, just to say, I concur with Councilor or Jody Croak about the sale of the building. It was decrepit. It probably wasn't as functional as most modern professionals would want a building to be for the caring of the healthcare practice. So it is sold, and I'm not sure if it'll go for housing or offices. But I've often wondered, nurse practitioners could probably see most people in community, you know, without necessarily having to access a medical doctor for most of the symptoms that people are presenting. I think the provincial government, who Cecil O'Donnell mentioned earlier, whose chief jurisdiction this is, should look into doing things like that and establishing that, because it would expedite, you know, the process of people who are suffering from illness that they don't really need to see a doctor, but they can be treated by a nurse practitioner, or as Mr. Gorm said, a walk-in clinic. Thank you.
Thank you. Tricia.
And I also had the same question. I didn't know why the building was shut down and not, like, why it was no longer a clinic, why there was not a new one brought in. But couldn't it be a possibility, like they have in the cities, that the drug stores could have pharmacists that could prescribe for simple ailments, ear infections, throat infections? You could go to the city and walk into a pharmacy, some of the pharmacies, get diagnosed and prescribed without actually having to see a doctor. There is a small fee, but I'm sure most people are willing to pay the small fee not to have to go sit at outpatients for hours and hours just to get a prescription. Thank you.
Thank you. Cecil O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Again, I would say that healthcare is the responsibility of the province. Any way you get around that, the province will dump it on the municipal units. And I can remember, you remember too, that and we spent hour after hour getting a request from the Municipality of Barrington that they could offer an incentive to bring doctors to it. And like you said, we spent good many nights awake there, and I think we finally got it through. You know, whether that was the right way to go or not, you know, I'm not really sure. But we do need health care, we demand it, and it's time for us to put some pressure on the provincial government to come through with their aid.
Thank you very much. Finishing up, but season swim.
Medical center, I believe what we need is something modern and up to date. New doctors are not going to go to that facility. I think it served a purpose at the time, but it was bought, and it was usefulness, and I would like to see something that would roll all of the medical services in one place, like a one-stop place, but where we have many things that are spread all over the community. They should be all brought together in terms of a center.
Thank you. And last would be Eddie Anderson. See, they're getting good at passing the potato there now.
It is the responsibility of the province, but we can build our community. We can put the infrastructure here that's going to attract professionals to come. If you look at successful communities, they have the infrastructure that brings professional medical people to the community. I would like to thank Cecil for putting the bill on the floor, Bill 64, I think it was, to enable the municipality to provide incentives. And as of today, the municipality is the only municipality in Nova Scotia that's legally able to provide an incentive to a doctor. It is illegal to do that, but the bill 64 that was passed, that the MLA at the time, Cecil, put on the floor, that was passed for this municipality. The building, speaking to the building, that building was sold because of maintenance issues. There was a lot of work, the roof was going on it, and Dr. Blair was on his way to retirement, and we didn't have the professionals to fill it, so that is the reason that building was sold. And we done the best we could at that time, and it's time to actually have a
new facility.
We had a buzzer. It's been a dream to have a
buzzer.
It will come.
Buzzer. All right, so we'll take a second one. Well, we got two more, so that's great. So please add.
Okay, so in 2014, the formation for the Regional Enterprise Network began in Nova Scotia in response to recommendations from the Regional Development Authority Review Panel in late 2012. So I'm sure you know what my question is going to be. As it stands, the Municipality of Barrington has yet to join either the Western Regional Enterprise Network or the South Shore Regional Enterprise Network. So my question is, do you think that the Municipality of Barrington should become involved with one of the regional enterprise networks, and why or why not?
All right, so we started with Jody this time. So we start with Joe on this one now. So, Mr. Gore.
Now you have the mic. Yes, I do think they should join. Be regional, but I think it would be a commitment that the municipality should do to join the regional department to be part of that infrastructure. I think it would be a benefit to the municipality. I think it's something to be debated. I think we should have an open debate on it. I think, transparency is going to be important in council. I think it should work for the people on the internet or wherever and however it is committed to the people, and I think the people should decide whether to go regional or not.
Thank you. Thank you. Murray Atkins.
Yes, I agree with Joel. We should to take a vote, join in those organizations. I'm not too familiar, so I don't know how council would act or whatnot, but I'm in favor of the organization. Thank you.
Sean. Thank you. I think we should join it as well. I think what happened, we were a part of the former economic development engine, SWASDA, and I think it was kind of like a bad marriage in the sense that we were finally divorced, and you know, you don't want to get married on the rebound, so I think council has been hesitant to jump into this new economic development regional engine that you're talking about. I think we should, you know, we should have healed by now. I think trust should be restored. I think we should join the REN for reasons, for example, this upgrading our internet delivery service. I think that's going to be an issue that needs to be tackled on a regional basis. I don't think one municipality can take that on alone. When it comes to some of the problems that the fishery's facing, I think we can address those, or in tourism, I think we can address those on a more regional basis than we can just in a, on an individual municipal council basis. So I would be all in for that. Thanks, Patricia.
This is not a subject that I'm very familiar with. I have to study it a little bit more, read up on it, and I don't want to give an answer because I really don't know that much about it. Thank you.
All right, so we'll see what's going on here. Wait about the other end. Are we ready?
My answer will be short. And I'm not really sure what the correct answer would be. And I think we've only been referred to before, and we had some scary results. And I also see that the municipality there can kind of go along with things.
Cecil Swin.
Yes, Swanson was a bad experience. I remember at the time I was on planning advisory. It was a terrible time for the municipality to go through, and I think it left a bad taste in a lot of people's mouth. But I did look at and read all of the information on REN when it came out, and I liked the format. From the surface, I like the format, and I in fact spoke to several councilors at the time, and thinking that we should look at REN, because I thought it was important. I've always been believe that we need to work together for economic development, and I thought that was an important place to be. I think we need to find out more about it and make sure that it's going to work for us. Thank
you. Mr. Nickerson.
Actually, when the REN's came about, I was working at that time, and I attended those initial meetings. I did then, and I still think today, that we need a regional body to help us, again, build our community so it's professional, to attract professionals. We are a community of 7,000 people. We all know that people work, people make money, people spend money. 7,000, we need to increase our population, I think, with professional business here, whether it's in Argyle or Yarmouth. And when we talk a regional REN, we're talking from Blair, from Digby to the Municipality of Barrington. That is, I think it's 11 units. I did push for that. I still support it. I think the council of today, with the discussions that we've had, certainly does support that. I'm pretty confident in saying if there was a motion to come forth out of this council today, that you would see us join that REN. REN's and development authorities are good tools to have when you're developing on a regional basis. Thank you.
Joey.
I guess my question would be, would anybody buy a used car before they can afford a test drive? That's the way I would sum up the REN. It's been prominent in my 4 years on council. It is a cost to the community. It's also what you get in return. We've watched SWASDA default and not be much more of a cost to the community. And how is it made up? Will we kind of step back and find out if it's a bureaucratic makeup, or is it actually going to be businesses in the community? Or is it going to be government officials? And if it is, who's going to be the strong person at that committee that's going to run things? There's always a type A personality in any meeting, and if you don't do what they like, sometimes you don't get your things passed through. So right now, I'm still on the fence, to be honest with you, as a counselor. We had the opportunity to look at it, and we're still in the debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So looking at the time, we're already 19:55. That's 7 o'clock, almost 8 o'clock. So we'll take one more from the floor, so I don't want the one to ask a question. And then, I mean, we could do another one if you wanted to, but I guess it depends on who wants to get home to the ball game. But we'll see how it goes. So, Juan.
Good evening. My question has to do about health, but it's something that hasn't been covered here yet tonight, and that's Bayside Home. I know there's a board of directors, and a municipal council sits on the board of Bayside Home, and I'm just wondering if you were a municipal councillor on the board of the Bayside Home, what you would do to work with Bayside Home to see that our seniors are cared for, if there's any improvements you could suggest, and also what you would do in the way of employee morale and keeping employees, the best employees that we can get at Bayside Home, because that is one of the assets of the community, and it's one of our better health assets for an aging population.
So Bayside Home, and we'll start with Murray Atkinson. What are your thoughts? Bayside Home.
Well, I think the council on there now is El Jaco right now. He's appointed. I think we have a councilor from the town, and also we have a couple people from the public on that board. I'm not familiar with that board yet. I do hear rumblings about Bayside Home, how it's being run. Now, what he or a counselor could do in that situation, I don't really know. But I think it'd be worth looking into, as you suggested, of what could be done through council. But we only have, I think right now, is one councilor represented on that board. So I don't know really just what to do. Thank you.
Sean Hatfield. Thank you. I've sat on board in the past and was always, I felt, willing to champion a whole process of evaluation. I think wherever you have any aspect of authority, whether it's us running for election, we should submit ourselves to people that are under that authority. And I think boards should be evaluated. I think councils should be evaluated. I think politicians should be evaluated. And people who are in, you know, management or any position should be open and transparent to any kind of feedback that might actually increase their abilities or performance professionally. So if the question is, if one of us as counselors was sitting on the board, what would we do to address? I think it comes back to, again, trust and transparency. I think people need to be willing to go the distance to ask the question, how can you give me feedback on what I'm doing? If I'm a staff member, if I'm in a position of administration, if I'm on the board, I need your feedback to do my job. And when people stop listening to feedback, then things don't go well. And I'm not suggesting that's happening. I don't know what's going on at Bayside Home because I haven't been part of the internal workings there for a few years. Thank you for your patience, Mr. DeAndremont. When you're ready.
Okay. I don't know much about Bayside Home. I have been there. I don't know anything about the runnings of it, morale, anything like that. But you could just ask for feedback. You could get them to tell you what they think, their opinions, what could be done to help improve the way it's run, the staff, the guests, I guess, at Bayside. Just listen. Just listen, and maybe there's something that could be done. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Cecil? I can say Cecil 1 or Cecil 2, but I don't know which one's older.
It's older than
Cecil 1.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a little history on Bayside Home. I can recall back, I guess it's the old part, this is inclusion in the park. The old park was to be demolished because of mold. And I want to personally thank Mrs. Rowe, and the team on the way back, Gina Wickens, and the town of Clyde Sarver that went there, and we visited the administrator of the day, and be able to get there today. I generally go to a Bayside at least once and maybe twice a week, and I have always found that the residents there are well cared for. People that are working there seem to be in a jolly mood. One even thought that I should have been a resident there. But no, I'm proud of the home there. It's a great facility. And if anything, the home should be enlarged because we have more calls for that. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Back over to Cecil 2. Mr. Swim, or Cecil 2. I think it's Logic 2.
Yeah, Bayside Home. Bayside Home is a tremendous asset for the community. I'm not sure that it's even. But the expansion is enough to need more. There's a long waiting list to get in. I do have to tell you that I've heard in knocking on doors a number of people who no longer work there who have serious issues with the way it's run. There are problems with Bayside. I'm not sure what the solution is, but it needs to be addressed.
Eddie Anderson. What I needed was a man of light carrying a microphone back and forth. Eddie.
Bayside Home. Bayside Home is ran by, first of all, I'd like to thank our MLA, Chris Nockman, back in 2008. I think it was a very passionate group of people.
We'll take 10 seconds off.
Yeah, sure. Very passionate group of people that lobbied for Bayside Home. I think a few of them sit in this room. I think a few of them sit at this table. I think the commitment was made in 2008 in Halifax and Alderney Landon. I can remember the day very specifically. I called Sean Hatfield after Chris Donkerman made the decision to commit 40 bids. So again, Chris, thank you, because that home would have been there if it wasn't for you.
Your 45 seconds starts now.
I think the Bayside, the board of directors that I personally don't feel a counselor should sit on Bayside. There's teetering on a conflict of interest there, too, because you have to deal with issues, municipal issues, that Bayside is involved in. So I think the board of directors should be compromised of community, and I think those board of directors that are there now are very capable of managing and giving the direction that they need to provide our seniors and the residents at Bayside the accommodations and the care that they need. So, again, just to reiterate, I think it's the job of our community and some very qualified people to step up. Thanks.
Flattery gets you everywhere. Jody.
Obviously, the board of directors for the health center is the ultimate authority. So, a member of council sitting on that board is just there to represent council and bring the voice of concern if there are issues. But ultimately, the board of directors are going to handle any issues with regards to morale or health conditions at that facility. But one thing is, we should build on the success of that building. Obviously, there's a demand for more beds in that building. And infrastructure upgrades are ongoing as we speak. I believe they either just completed or getting into the final touches of completing. So, thank you.
Thanks, Jody. Joe, last word.
Well, I strongly disagree with Mr. Nickerson. First of all, you have a beautiful home here. I work in child at the home there. And you have a modern building. We have a 40-year-old building. And seniors are doing very well in the modern facility where they have their own room and they don't share a washroom. I think that I would welcome the opportunity to sit on the board there and ask the tough questions that need to be asked of the inner workings of the manor, of Bayside, because there's strife in each facility. Of course, you have over 100 workers in there, but I've worked there 1 month on the ground floor, and I've gone from environmental worker to maintenance supervisor and in between, and definitely I would love the opportunity to get in and ask the hard questions to change Bayside and get it going in the direction it needs to go. Thank you.
Very much. The last issue that I have, I have a couple issues, but I think the one that has been brought up here a couple times already, so I think we're going to spend a few moments on that one, which is the issue of lack of internet service in our area. The provincial government announced next steps in June towards providing high-speed internet to more rural communities. These steps include asking municipalities to bring forward proposals, issuing a call for information from service providers, and hiring a team with technical expertise to develop a detailed plan and work with communities on projects for further development. Do you think municipal dollars should be invested for additional infrastructure to bring high speed to our community? And if so, how do you feel the best way to do it? Okay. And Mark was the first one this time, so Sean will kick off this one.
I definitely think that without high-speed internet, we're at a, as I mentioned a couple of times tonight, at an educational disadvantage, and we're at a business disadvantage in our community. It's something that needs to be addressed. And again, I think joining the REN, I think it's a regional issue. I think municipalities need to partner together. And I think if you partner together, the economics that will be needed to make it happen, it can happen. And rural communities don't necessarily have to be at the disadvantage that they're currently at. And so networking, I think, is the best way to do it. I don't think any municipality is going to cough up the amount of money that it's going to take to bring high-speed internet to their community when they have to travel with the fiber optics all the way down from the valley somewhere. You need to partner with other municipalities to make that happen. And I do think it needs to happen because I think it does put us in a place of disparity in relation to other areas that are more, they have access to high-speed internet. Educationally and economically, they're going to be doing better. We want to be in that place.
I also agree with that. We do need high-speed internet. We do have at present time high-speed internet, or so they call it high-speed internet. It is not. And I think a big part of the problem is some of the lines are so old that they just can't support what they're trying to bring in. I think you need to start upgrading all the lines, running the high-speed internet from the start, but it's going to take more than just municipalities, and that you have to have a lot more people join together in order to get that done.
So Cecil will help.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm not very much up to date on these concerns, but my question is, again, why is everything coming back to the municipality? They always come back to the municipal government to a funding this project. And the day has come, or I believe the day has come, the time has come, that we should have put down the study on this amount. Thank you, Chair.
Right. Mr. Swim?
I have to tell you, at the fair point, every other house talks high speed. Have a wireless system down there that just doesn't cut it. And they tell me it's a job to do internet banking on it. And a lot of people get discouraged to stop in the bed. The other thing that's amazing that I found out on traveling around, I actually talked to someone, their son works for Eastlink. The cables are there. Eastlink or private enterprise are waiting for the government to chuck in money so they can actually just turn it on because the cable is there. It's a political thing that's going on, politics, and I don't know, I just don't have any patience.
Good, thank you. Eddie?
Actually, if I'm not mistaken, I think there is this kind of endeavor that's being taking place in the valley. I'm not sure. I think it's where our new CAO comes from, Hans Porter, or Annapolis, or somewhere there. So the municipalities are it is, it's not a new concept. So I do think there can be some collaboration or work to work together with other municipal units and other levels of government to accomplish this. Even though I thought that there was, we had high-speed internet on the island, right? I think Lisette might have been the first one to get high-speed over there, and I think I was the second. And I thought I had high-speed. While I was campaigning, I met a couple that moved from Alberta to Stony Island, and they have a, she's working out of there. And she told me that even though it's high-speed internet, it isn't compatible. So there's not, it's not just Bear Point or Latour, it is the entire municipality. So just one last thing, I think there needs to be a push on the service providers to provide this, because there's been $20 million+ given to service providers to do this. Thank you.
Okay, Mr.
Crook. He stole my thunder. Mr. Gjorsmark going on like my answer. Okay. So it's another one of those push downs from the provincial government that I think should have been dealt with. Should have pushed East Lake and Bowell Line and follow through with their promises of providing more internet to communities, and they didn't do their job, and no one's holding them accountable, and I think their problems is the best way to go. These programs, sure, the federal government's going to match our funding, but unfortunately, we can't put up $9 million to run a cable down to the back road, for example. I mean, where's the money going to come from? That's a large undertaking for any municipality, especially the municipality of Barrington. Thank you.
Thank you. Doesn't hurt my feelings, though.
I thought you were going to give 20 seconds.
So.
Yes, I think high-speed internet is a no-brainer. We live in an ever-changing world. Things are changing quickly, and even our small communities are changing quickly. And if we don't act, we fall behind. Yeah, the province did drop the ball, most certainly, but the smaller towns than us, Nova Scotia, that have high-speed internet, and I think council needs to make it a priority. At least start the ball rolling to get us high-speed internet. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, on this one, Murray Atkins.
Yes, sir. I agree with this high-speed internet. As Cecil mentioned, I campaigned down in Bear Point, especially West Bear Point, and those students there are in a very disadvantaged, there's no high-speed internet. And it also is a disadvantage to the business in the area. And I got to agree with Mr. Crook, I think the burden should lie on Bell and Alliance for not providing those things. They should have. Thank you.
All right, thank you. So that finishes up that issue. I'll now do a 1 minute or so round, because I know what I say, what happens here when I give you time limits. Eddie, you go over. Nothing. And she who was last at the beginning is now the first. So, Tricia, you have some final comments before we finish up tonight. 1 minute each of you to finish up.
Once again, I'd just like to thank everyone for coming out. And I just want to say, if I'm elected, I don't know what I can or can't do. I'm new at this. I'll just listen and try and do what I possibly can. Try and take into consideration what you're asking for. And hopefully just kind of go with it. And I've never been in the government, so I don't know what can or cannot be done. So, thank you.
Good. Thank you. Just so you guys know, that's 30 seconds. Mr. O'Donnell.
Cecil.
This campaign has been a great adventure for me. I can personally say that through serving on Plan Point, Southside, and Hawk, I don't believe there's as many signs between me and Eddie than throughout the municipality of Barrington combined. But I just want to mention a few accomplishments that were made while I was in council and the provincial government. We built a new municipal administration center. Bayside Home was rebuilt. Municipal garbage was started, collection. Municipal street lighting was started. And the 103 bypass was completed. This election is not about myself, but it's about the whole municipality of Barrington. And I ask for your support and say I would be honored to be your counselor. Thank you.
Perfect. Eddie.
Oh,
sorry for ceaseless listening. We'll get clear with you out here.
I've been walking, I'm knocking on doors for 3.5 weeks. It's been a real experience. My first time, first campaign for public government. And I found that either I'm there a minute or I'm there an hour, because I spent whatever time, and I'm still knocking on doors. I still got to go. And I've had a wonderful conversation with a great number of people. I devoted many hours to many organizations in the municipality, and so I came to the conclusion. I thought, why do I do this? Why do I go out to a community and work? And I think I came to the conclusion that I have a desire, I think, for our community to be the best it can be. And I just, that's what drives me to be good. Thank you.
Thank you, Cecil. Back to Eddie.
Said in
30 seconds?
45. Why do I do it? I love it. There's no other words. I just love it. I would like to thank everyone, especially the candidates, Chamber, Chris, and you guys for attending. Again, just to recap some issues, development of beaches, state-of-the-art medical clinic, paving of roads, and just to update the residents. In discussions with transportation, the remainder of Southside Road is scheduled to be paved in 2017. I think I have a proven track record. Being warden for the municipality, I think the leadership is proven. We've taken a council from that was of seven and made it five, and certainly built a good working team. We've seen the development at the causeway again, and some great things have been done. So I'd like to thank the residents of District 4 for the trust that they have put in me, and the residents of the municipality that has put their trust in me also. And on October the 15th, I do respectfully ask for your support so we can continue to build the community, District 4 and the municipality of Barrington. Thank you.
Ready? Joey?
I'll be truthful, municipal. As a municipal council, it's been difficult and challenging to understand how the federal and provincial government continue to download responsibilities to the municipal level without the financial support. Municipalities have become more creative to sustain services and improve infrastructure without impacting the taxpayer. We've had the lowest tax for the last 4 years. As a councilor, you will have to be aware of working for the entire municipality and also working for your district. I believe I've shown over the past 4 years dedication, experience, the tenacity to continue to move this community forward in a responsible manner. And so for those who doubt me, come October the 15th, ask yourself, do you want experience, passion, and a business-minded candidate to represent you? And if you do vote, at least vote for an honest crook.
All right, so far that's the best tagline we got so far. All right, Joel.
I started business 10 years ago in tourism, and I remember standing at the terminal. I had a small van back then, waiting for the people to get off the cab. Everybody passed me by except the last two people. And I jumped in my van and took them to Cape Save Along. We were walking on the beach. And it was a foggy day, and I looked coming out of the distance with the gentleman, and I knew him, so we stopped and talked, and I knew he was a light keeper, and we started talking about the light, Cape Light. And the woman just stood there with her mouth open, and we left and got back in the van. She said, "I'll cherish that for the rest of my life." I had to talk to a light keeper. And right then and there, I realized what we had in this area is very important, and we had the most wonderful people in the area also. And I just asked for the opportunity to represent the area, and I have a passion for helping the community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Where are we at?
Thank you. I'd like to thank the Chalmers, Tom, for inviting us here tonight, and the audience. And I'll probably work hard as anybody else for this community and try to do the best I can. I'm retired now, and so I know the issues of Barrington. I've been living there for the past 28 years, and I'll work hard to implement the issues I had for me. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally would be Mr. Hatfield.
Awesome. I want to thank you all for running. It's been a really good clean campaign, and I've thoroughly enjoyed it. Our fathers were best friends, and it's great to be, you know, offering for office. People say, I hear you're running against Joel, or Joel's running against you, and I say, no, we're running for District 3 seat. It belongs to the people. We never would be running against each other. I would close just with the comments that are on my election brochure. As a child, many times I looked up over the meat counter at Hatfield's Market to ask, how can I serve you today? And since childhood, that one question has shaped my life and made me who I am. As a volunteer, I work with others to get a new school for our youth, and I sought to get Bayside Home expanded for our seniors, and the same childhood question guided me. How can I serve you today? As a pastor, I'm with people through times of sorrow, during happy times like weddings, and in these instances, the same childhood passion motivates me. How can I serve you today? I wish to thank you for giving me the opportunity to serve you as a municipal councillor over these past 7 years. It's been a high privilege. I'd love the opportunity to continue serving you, the people of District 3, and therefore I ask for your ongoing support. There's two things in life they say you should avoid. One's politics and the other's religion. Here I am.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you found it informative. I hope it maybe helps you make a decision when the 15th comes around. Again, the reminder that, of course, the advance polls are on the 8th and on the 11th, and of course, the main poll on Saturday the 15th. Thank you to the Chamber for helping us organize this. It's the first time I've been on this side of the debate. It's kind of fun being Speaker of the House here, so we'll hope we can do this again. But I can say on my behalf, as MLA for the region, that whoever the winners are in the 15th, I look forward to working with each and every one of them. So thank you for putting your names forward. Thank you for your informative talks tonight. And good luck to everybody. Have a good night. Baseball game's still on. Thank you.